Hi, my name is Eric Tanner. I'm a licensed clinical professional counselor and a certified rehabilitation counselor. This next presentation, let me give you a little bit of background on it. I've given this several times when I was tasked to go into high schools and present on employment-related situations. I would do a workshop on finding better jobs and actually helping kids develop a resume. And I put this together to really inspire people on how to overcome barriers in life. And one of the things you want to think about is, what are you going to become someday? What do you want to do with your life? And the title of this presentation is Empowerment in Your Career Development. And it's really overcoming poverty and becoming self-reliant. All right, so one of the things I want you to think about is what do you want to be? What do you want to do? If you could have whatever you wanted in life, what would you like to become? And I would like to start off by sharing some videos, and I will pause this while you watch them. They're just some video clips, and it will kind of help you help illustrate the point of where I'm going with this. So, I'll go ahead and start the first one. It's a clip from the Disney movie Lion King.
Look down there.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me. Father!
Like about this is if anyone's watched the movie, they can kind of see that Simba has kind of forgotten who he is. He's the one true king. And he sees a vision of his father in the cloud, and he's like, you've forgotten me. Like, how could I forget you? You know, you're my father. You know, and you know, basically he says, you're more than what you've become. Take your place in the circle of life. And says, remember who you are. And I think sometimes we forget what we can become because of what we've been through in life. Now, the next video clip here that I would like to share with you, it's from The Neverending Story.
Art.
Thank you.
And you, whoever you are, can have the honor of being my last victim.
I will not die easily. I am a warrior.
Brave warrior. Then fight for nothing.
But I can't! I can't get beyond the boundaries of Fantasia! What's so funny about that?
Fantasia has no boundaries.
That's not true! You're lying!
Foolish boy. Don't you know anything about Fantasia? It's the world of human fantasy. Every part, every creature of it, is a piece of the dreams and hopes of mankind. Therefore, it has no boundary.
Fantasia dying then?
Because people have begun to lose their hopes and forget their dreams. So the nothing grows stronger.
What is the nothing?
It's the emptiness that's left. It is like a despair destroying this world. And I have been trying to help it.
But why?
Because people who have no hopes are easy to control. And whoever has the control has the power.
Who are you, really?
I am the servant of the power behind the nothing. I was sent to kill the only one who could have stopped.
In this clip we just watched, you know, the setting here is Atreyu, who's the hero of the story, is tasked to find why his world, Fantasia, is dying. And he is told he has to get beyond the boundaries of his world called Fantasia. And he meets up with this evil wolf, which is his nemesis, and he doesn't quite know it yet. And so when he says, I'm a warrior, I won't die easily, and he said, well, fight the nothing. He's like, well, how can I fight that? That's the thing destroying Fantasia. And he says, you know, there's no boundaries. So how can you get to the boundaries of Fantasia to fight the nothing? He's like, that's not true. You're lying. And a lot of times, we our adversaries can have some truth in what they say, which makes it even more, frustrating. You know, and he's like, you don't know anything about Fantasia. Fantasia is a world of human fantasy. Every part, every creature is part of some hopes and dreams of mankind. Therefore, it has no boundaries. And then he's like, why is Fantasia dying? And as you heard from the video clip, it's because people have forgotten their hopes and their dreams. So the nothing is growing stronger. It's what's left. It's the emptiness that's left behind. It's like despair destroying their world. And he's like, well, I've been trying to help it. And the hero Atreyu is like, but why? You know, when people have no hope, they're easy to control, and whoever has the control has the power. And basically, you know, Gamork, who's the wolf, the evil wolf, is a servant of the power behind the nothing. He was sent to kill the one that could stop the nothing. Then there's a battle, and Atreyu beats Gamork. But the whole point was is that when you lose your hope, it's hopes and dreams, you're easily controlled. And so keep that in mind. Let me go to the next clip here. So this next clip is going to be from Star Wars: Empire Strikes Back, the original trilogy.
stupid?
Size matters not. Look at me. Does me by my size, do you? And where you should not. For my ally is the Force. And a powerful ally it is. Life creates it. Makes it grow. Its energy surrounds us. And binds us. Luminous beings are we, not this crude matter. You must feel the Force around you. Here, between you, me, the tree, the rock, everywhere. Yes, even between the land and the ship.
You want the impossible.
All right, we get from this clip that Luke is talking to Yoda, and he's trying to train him how to use the Force, and anyone who's watched Star Wars knows that, hey, you can pick things up with your mind, but he's training Luke here. He's like, picking up stones is easy, you know, that's fine. And then he notices ship sinking in the swamps, and he's like, well, go and go use the Force. He's like, but that's different. Yeah, the only difference is in your mind. The a little task versus a large task. And he's saying, you got to unlearn what you've learned. He's like, I'll give it a try. And the biggest quote that I like from this is, no, try not, do not, or do not. There is no try, you know. And he's like, I can't, it's too big. Size matters not. Look at me. Judge me for my size, do you, And he shakes his head, and then Yoda uses the Force and lifts the ship out of the water and lands it on the ground, and, Luke looks at him, sits down, and goes, I don't believe it. And Yoda looks at him and says,
that is why you fail.
You know, think about it. He didn't believe it could happen, so that's why you fail. You have to believe in order to find the possibilities out there. You know, finding that belief that things are possible. All right, the next clip is going to be from Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers.
Do this, Sam. I know. It's all wrong. But rights, we shouldn't even be here. But we are. It's like in the great stories, Mr. Fertile. The ones that really mattered. Full of darkness and danger they were. And sometimes you didn't want to know the end. Because how could the end be happy? How could the world go back to the way it was when so much bad had happened? But in the end, it's only a passing thing. The shadow. Even darkness must pass. A new day will come. And when the sun shines, it'll shine out the clearer. Those were the stories that stayed with you. That meant something. Even if you were too small to understand why. But I think, Mr. Furlow, I do understand. I know now. Folk in those stories had lots of chances of turning back, only they didn't. They kept going. Because they were holding on to something. What are we holding on to, Sam? But there's some good in this world, Mr. Fertile. And it's worth fighting for.
Now, I really like this clip because it's kind of showing a point where Sam and Frodo are kind of at a crossroads here, and they're like trying to figure out what to do. They're frustrated. They're going through a lot of trials and trying to destroy this very evil object that is supposed to bring destruction to the world. You know, and I really think about that when you are contemplating, you know, you hear about the stories where the hero kind of is battling through it, and you know, we've all heard these stories from different movies, from from our childhood to now, and so when you're thinking about all the things that you've been, why didn't they give up? You know, because they're holding on to something, and of course, for Frodo's like, what are we holding on to, Sam? That there's some good in this world, and it's worth fighting for. And so when you're thinking about it, you are the good that's worth fighting for. You're the future. You know, as when I presented this for youth, I would tell them that. I said, hey, you know what? You are the future. And that's what we're fighting here for. No matter what you've been through, think about that as you're going through, you know, your teenage years and you're trying to explore what you want to do with your life and really kind of imagine that, hey, you know what? There's still good left in this world and you're worth fighting for. So keep that in mind. Okay. My last clip, and this is another one from Lion King.
What was that? The weather. Very peculiar, don't you think?
Yeah. Looks like the winds are changing.
Change is good.
Yeah, but it's not easy. I know what I have to do, but going back means I'll have to face my past. I've been running from it for so long. Ow! Jeez, what was that for?
It doesn't matter. It's in the past.
Yeah, but it still hurts.
Oh, yes, the past can hurt. But the way I see it, you can either run from it or learn from it. Ah! You see? So what are you going to do?
First, I'm going to take your stick.
No! That's a stick! Hey! Where are you going?
I'm going back!
Good! Get out of here!
You know, right after Simba sees his father in the clouds, sees his ghost telling him that he's the one true king, then he starts wandering off, and then this wise monkey named Rafiki comes up to him and he's like, oh, the winds are changing, huh? He's like, yeah, change is good, but it's not easy. And, you know, he's like, yeah. So what he does is he, tells, Rafiki's been running for so long, he doesn't know what to do. And Rafiki whacks him over the head with the stick. He's like, what'd you do that for? Doesn't matter, it's in the past. He starts laughing, and he's like, yeah, but it still hurts. We have to realize that, yes, the past can hurt. The things we've experienced in life, the trials and the things that cause hopelessness. But the way that Rafiki says it is that you can either run from it or you can learn from it. So when he tries to whack Simba over the head again, he actually ducks. And then he starts taking off, and then decides, I got to go fix this. Some mistakes he felt he made, and he got to go save his kingdom. And I think that sometimes what we have to think about is that, you know, we can either run from it or we can learn from it. You know, and that I think a really good point to think about when dealing with trauma and different things that we've experienced. So that brings me to my next point. What is our human potential? You know, one aspect that, you know, we're digging our grave, despair and fear. We kind of live in that and feel hopeless. On the other hand, we reach for the stars. We have our hopes and our dreams. And really kind of think about, what is our potential? I think, you know, we're like an unwritten novel with the end torn out, a written novel that, with the end torn out. We don't know what the ending is going to be, but we have a lot of potential, a lot of different things that can happen. I think we forget about our potential because we get so bogged down in the struggles that we face that we can't see beyond that. We get blinded by the trials and the challenges that we face. And I think that we all have this greatness. And I think it's not the exception, but the rule. We all have this potential to do great things. You know, think of our possibilities. They're endless. And using our imagination, kind of like a childlike imagination, when I think about it, the laser was thought of as a comic book way before, comic strips, way before it was ever used in surgery. You know, the cell phone idea came out of Star Trek when they had those little flip phone communicators. And they came into cell phones. We don't really have the flip phones anymore, excuse me. But we see that, you know, someone imagined it and then created it. You know, some authors that I would recommend, M. Scott Peck, The Road Less Traveled, Viktor Frankl, The Man's Search for Meaning, David Peltzer, A Child Called It. You know, a lot of these people have had some, difficult things happen in their life, and they were able to find a way to find their potential to go where they want to go in life. Thomas Edison, you know, we all know who he is, an inventor. He tried over 10,000 different ways to make the incandescent light bulb. He tried and failed. It took only one time. one of the philosophers that I really admire is Epictetus. He's a Stoic philosopher, and he came up with a concept that you can't control anyone around you, but you can control your mind. And why would you give that power to someone else? No matter what happens to me, what you do to me, I can still control what I think, and I'm not going to allow you the power to change that. The difference between acting and reacting. Most of us are reactors. We react to what's going on around us. But it takes some special talent to be able to be an actor and act for ourselves, especially if you have ever had an experience driving, you're on the road, and someone cuts you off. What's our immediate response is to react. Instead of thinking, oh, that person is maybe late for their job and they've been unemployed for 6 months and they're trying to get to that job and they cut you off and they didn't even think about it. But no, we want to flip them off and call them a name while you react. So, what I try to do is think about that. What are people's intentions? Maybe instead of react, I'm going to act for myself and choose not to react. And, that can also help us in how we deal with people and what we want to do with our life. One of the things that I think is really good is to kind of think about the impossible. A lot of us think, oh, that's impossible. There's no way to get through this. There's no way to get around it. There's a song that I really like called The Impossible by Joe Nichols, and I'm going to read some of the lyrics. My dad chased monsters from the dark. He checked underneath my bed. He could lift me up with one arm up over his head. He could loosen rusty bolts with a quick turn of his wrench. He pulled his splinters in, from his hand and never flinched. In 13 years, I've never seen him cry, but the day Grandpa died, I realized unsinkable ships sink, unbreakable walls break. Sometimes things you never could think could happen just like that. Unbendable steel bends. In the fury of the wind is unstoppable. I've learned to never underestimate the impossible. And it kind of goes on from there, but it's a really good point. So don't tell me it's over. And don't give up on you and me, because there's no such thing as hopeless if you believe that unsinkable ships sink and unbendable walls break. That, you know, in the fury of the wind is unstoppable. I've learned to never underestimate the impossible. What I challenge here to do is to dream big. You know, if you think you're small in a big, big world, that may be the case, but I challenge you to think about dreaming big and looking at the options out there, what's possible, overcoming, and what do you want to do with your life? What do you want to become? Another song that I like is from the play A Man from La Mancha, The Impossible Dream, and I like to read those lyrics to you. It is the mission of each true knight, his duty, nay, his privilege, to dream of the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear the unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love, pure and chaste, from afar, to try when your arms are too weary to reach the unreachable stars. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know, if only to be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I am laid to rest, my rest. And the world will be better for this, for that one man scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable stars. Sometimes it's going to take a little bit of effort to get where you want to go. So if we think about it, you know, I mentioned about that I would go into the high schools and teach individuals about resumes and interviewing and talking to employers and finding that job. You know, as we get older, you kind of figure out, what are we going to do with our life? You know, do you have a dream of what you want to become or what you want to do? So let's say you do have a dream. You have some ideas of what you want to do. And you're able to form one. One of the things that we have to kind of focus on is a dream versus reality. Can the two meet? You know, we can sit and imagine all day, you know, what do I want to be? You know, I want to become a superhero, or I want to be this or that. Is it a dream, and can it become a reality? The other option is to think about a career versus a hobby. You know, can I have a career to pay for the things that I enjoy, or can my hobby that I like to do in my spare time become a career? And they don't have to, you know, you don't have to have your hobby be your career. You don't have to have your career be your hobby. And so there's, different things to look at and see what the options are. So if we're looking at career, the first thing I like to ask is, why do we work? Think about that for a minute. Why do we work? Well, of course, it's money, right? We want money, you know? And I think a lot of times we get confused with, if you're a religious person, there's a scripture in the Bible that says, we always often quote it wrong. You know, we always think for the love, you know, for the root of all evil is money. But that actual quote is, for the love of money is the root of all evil. You know, and so we're not talking about being in love with money. We're just using it for our necessities and maybe some of those few minor luxuries we like to enjoy by providing for a future family or, be able to have enough to help other people. And so when I think about, what we need is like housing. You know, if you're still young, are you going to live with your mom and dad the rest of your life? Are you going to be able to live in their home? What happens when they pass away? You know, you're going to want to have a roof over your head, right? You know, some of us want to have a big house someday, maybe a small apartment. Other things like, you know, if there's things that are necessity, who likes food? You can tell I like food, you know. And so think about that, you know. How are you going to pay for that eventually when, you know, your shelves run dry or your parents don't pay for it anymore because you're, you know, in your mid-20s, you know? Think about it, you know, playing video games. Who likes to play video games, you know? The latest video game out there, you know, can you imagine in the future, you know, 10 years from now when the PlayStation 20 comes out and you hook up sensors in a room and it turns into a 3D graphic room and you can, you know, imagine, you know, shooting down the bad guys. You know, and you have your, you know, you don't even use a VR set. The whole room is like a holodeck off of Star Trek. So that's something you want to think about, is how are you going to pay for that? Also, hanging out with your friends, you know. Those are kind of things we like to do. And if you have money to do those activities that you want to do, then you're going to probably be able to do a lot more than just literally hanging out, you know, just sitting there doing nothing. Recreation, you know, how many of you want to, you know, go to the gym, you know, do water sports, play soccer, you know, do motocross or, you know, paintball, you know, getting out and having fun, you know, eventually that soccer is going to go, that soccer ball is going to go flat. How are you going to pay for that new one? You need the money to do those kind of things. So, as I mentioned before, living your dream doesn't mean you have to do it as a career. And, you know, for example, hobbies. You want to write a novel on the side? You know, maybe wait and do that until it takes off. Paint pictures. Playing video games, that's still fun. Being able to do it as a career, or I may. Playing with pets, you know, volunteer at a homeless shelter. Those are a lot of things you can do that, you know, necessarily they don't have to be a career, but you can have a career that you can use to play, you know, pay for your hobbies. So when we talk about bridging the gap between dream versus reality, here's some questions to ask. Research. How am I going to get there? How long will it take to get there? And what will I do in the meantime? And how much money do you want to make? And I recommend a great website called MyNextMove.org. It's a great website. It will help you kind of explore some of those options. And it will help you know how much money you can make to... you know, what kind of education you need, those kind of things, to what the job market looks like for the future. And so that's a really good tool to go in there and use that website to really help look at those options and kind of see what kind of, you know, future you want to have. You know, do I want to have a nice two-car garage home with a swimming pool in the backyard and a trampoline and the latest game system and maybe have enough for a bunch of kids or no kids, you know, maybe you just want to have fun for yourself, that kind of thing. So the first thing is talking about things in the short term. You know, here's a lot of examples that I've heard. I want to work with animals. Working with animals is great. But as, you know, early as the working age, you know, 14, 15, 16, you can start looking at a job working with animals. Well, one of the things, the reality is you may be able to work in a kennel or volunteer at a pound or an animal shelter. And the thing of it is because you don't have any medical training, you're probably going to pick up dog poop. You know, you're going to have to clean kennels. Are you comfortable with that? Can you deal with feces? If not, may not be something you want to do right off the bat. Long-term, working with animals, you're going to need a lot of math and science classes. And you're going to have to deal with blood if you ever do surgeries on animals. You know, and so one of the things you got to think about is can you deal with that? Can you deal with 8 years of medical school or 8 years of college to learn how to operate and work and save animals? Those are the kind of things you got to think about is, can I do that? A lot of us get caught up in job titles when it's really the tasks that you do every day. And because of the options out there, it's okay to be a little picky and choosy and find out what you want to do and what you're going to value. Also, you know, video game designer. In the interim, what you could do right now is there's a Scratch. It's through MIT, and it's a 2D video game software program that you can use. It's free. You can create your stories. It's really good to kind of see what's out there when it comes to coding, and very easy to learn. And so I'd recommend checking it out and just kind of doing a search for Scratch through MIT. And kind of see what it's about. in the long term, you're going to have to do a lot of math and computer programming. You're going to have to learn how to do algorithms. And if you're not really big in mathematics, or you're not a big fan of that, you know, most people that go into video game design have to do a lot of coding, and after you see sitting there in front of a computer screen, you're not just sitting there testing them out and playing games all day long. And so you got to see, what do you do every day as a video game designer? And do I really want to do that? You know, and kind of go from there. So one of the things that I would like to kind of disclose here is that you can kind of change your dreams. I wanted to become a veterinarian, and that's why I picked animals, and I want to work with animals. I worked in a vet clinic for 4 years in my high school years. I assisted with a few surgeries here and there, got used to dealing with the blood. I also had to clean up dog poo. That was a big component of helping out and cleaning up dogs in kennels, and I also helped clean them and bathe them, which wasn't the most fun thing to do, but I did it. I wanted to go into computers. I took some classes when I actually was pretty good at it. I'm very tech savvy to a certain degree, but I found at the time it was kind of boring. Now I work as a counselor. I also own my own business, and I love what I do. And so, you know, yes, you can have a dream, and I would challenge people not to say you can't obtain what you want, but you look at comparing the reality of it, and then realize that I can find other dreams too, and it's okay to change it. So I will disclose again, my journey to finding where I want to be took a while. I worked in an animal hospital, two different animal hospitals. I was a pet groomer, or worked with a pet groomer. I was a valet. I worked in a thrift store. I worked at a movie theater, at several fast food places. I was a security guard for a while. I also worked in an elementary school. I worked with people with disabilities with several different companies. I also was an employment counselor, and then now I'm a therapist counselor and a business owner. And so one of the things that I had to go through my own journey starting at age 14 is I've had over 31 different jobs. You know, and that may be a little excessive, but it took me a while to figure out where I was going to go. And I don't want to discourage people from finding that, but you can still find it. I want you to know you can achieve great things, but it's going to take hard work. A lot of people think success is a straight line, where we start down here at the ground and you kind of go up. But sometimes you're going to do some squiggly turns and twists and turns, and then you're going to get where you're going to go. That's what it really looks like. So I want you to kind of think about that. You know, I want you to challenge your fear and to do something new. You dare. You must dream to live and endure to make it come true. If you don't have a dream, you will live in a nightmare and long for death to come to pass. It's a quote I heard once and I like it. You start with your dream, and then you kind of see, you know, where can it take me? What can I do with it? And the possibilities are out there. I want to thank you for watching this presentation, hopefully you enjoyed it and learned a few things. And know that, you know what, challenge yourself, get out there and do it, with a little bit of struggle, you're going to find where you can go in life, and you don't have to live in that fear and doubt and have that despair that you can't overcome. Thank you.